In the previous lecture, we looked at equations and we solved for x. Now that we have those building blocks, let's concentrate on quadratic equations. We're even going to develop a formula which we can use to solve all quadratic equations.
So quadratic equations. So I'll put inverted commas, solving for x. Eventually we're going to do some, let's call it proper algebra, we're going to solve for x. Let's remind ourselves of what a quadratic equation is. So let's do things a little bit different. Let's start with our little marker there. Let's say this is a definition for quadratic equations. So a quadratic equation, you will remember, that is just a second order polynomial. So in previous lectures, we would have written a sub 2 x to the power 2 plus a sub 1 times x to the power 1 plus a sub 0 x to the power 0, which is just 1 equals 0. It's an equation, left hand side, right hand side. Now here we're just going to change. We won't use a sub 2, a sub 1 and a sub 0. We'll just say ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0. That's just something that we use more commonly when we talk about second order. We just have to have here that, say, a sub 2 is not equal to 0, or here a is not equal to 0. We can't have the leading coefficient 0, otherwise that term falls away, and then we have a first degree polynomial. And do notice here that I'm just replacing these constants, so it's the coefficients. A sub 2 is equal to a sub 1 is equal to b, a sub 0 is equal to c. I'm just using different symbols, rewriting it here. We also note that a and b and c, they are all members of the real numbers. So let's talk about solutions. Solutions, I'm going to say, for the unknown. Ooh, that looks horrible. Solutions for the unknown x. Another way to talk about this is the roots. So when the right-hand side is 0, what values of x would be 0 on the left-hand side? Those would be the roots of our equation. Now later on we'll see that these roots, they can be elements or members of the real numbers, but they can also be, roots can also be elements of the complex numbers. Now that's quite interesting, but for most part we're going to stick to the real numbers. Let's have a little example. So let's have something like x squared, let's have plus 5x plus 6 equals 0. Now we know this has to be two of these factors, and there's a leading coefficient 1 there, so we'll have an x in next, such that we get x squared. Now we have to think of two integers, that if we multiply them, we get to 6, and somehow combine the two of them with addition and subtraction so that we get to 5. Now, I think what would work for us here is positive 3 and positive 2. The more of these that you do, the easier this becomes. So x times x is x squared, and then 3 times 2 is 6, so I do have those. But I also have 2x, and I also have here 3x. So 2x plus 3x gives me the 5x. Now we have to make something, make use of something called the zero product property. So let's put a little green marker there, because that is something else I want for you to remember. We call this the zero product or zero multiplication property. And that says the following. If I have two numbers, say P and Q, and I multiply them and I get 0, then either we have to have that P equals 0 or Q equals 0. If I have 3 times 0, that's 0, or 0 times 3 is 0. One of the two must be 0 if I multiply two numbers to be 0. And look at this. If I plug in a value for x, I'll have one number here, I'll have another number there. So one of the two of them better be 0, so if I multiply this by this, that I do get 0. There's no other way to do that. And so we're going to have that x plus 3 is equal to 0, this term equal to 0, or this fact equal to 0, or x plus 2 is equal to 0. One of these two must sum to 0 for me to have 0 times something or something times 0. And so here we're just going to subtract 3 from both sides, so 0 minus 3. So I've just subtracted 3 from both sides, and positive 3, negative 3, that's just x plus 0, and that's just x. And on this side, we're going to have our negative 3, So we have x equals negative 3. On this side, we have x plus 2. I'm just going to subtract 2 from this side, and I'm going to subtract 2 from the right-hand side, so nothing changes. And again, plus 2, negative 2 is just 0, so I'll just skip a step and just leave that x on its own on the left-hand side and negative 2 on the right-hand side. And that is fantastic. Now, what can we do? Well, what we can do is to verify the solution. And it's lovely that we can verify these solutions, and we do that by substitution, because I can plug in these values for x right there in my original equation. It's an equation. I've got a left-hand side equal to right-hand side. And if this on the left-hand side is equal to 0, then I have 0 equals 0, which is exactly a nice verification of my results. So let's start with the first one, x equals negative 3. Let's start with that. X equals negative 3. So there's my equation. Instead of x, I'm substituting negative 3, so there'll be a negative 3 squared plus 5 times, instead of x, I have negative 3 plus 6 equals 0. Negative 3 times negative 3 is 9. 5 times negative 3 is negative 15, and I have positive 6, and that equals 0. And indeed, 9 plus 6 is 15, minus 15 is 0, equals 0. Absolutely, I verified that that solution is correct. Let's do x equals negative 2. Let's substitute that in. So I'm going to have negative 2 squared plus 5 times negative 2 plus 6 equals 0. Negative 2 times negative 2 is 4. 5 times negative 2 is negative 10, plus that 6 equals 0, and 4 plus 6 is 10, minus 10, 0 equals 0. This solution is correct as well. Let's do another example. Let's have 4x squared, let's do plus 5x minus 6 equals 0. It's a quadratic equation. I'm going to have two factors equal to 0. Now I've got a leading 4, so I've got to multiply two integers to get 4. I've got to multiply two integers to get negative 6. How can I use that to get to 5? The more of these you do, the better. What if I think of about 8 and 3? Because with an 8 and with a 3, I can get 5. 8 minus 3 is 5. How can I get 8? Well, what if I make this a 4x and an x? What if I do a positive 2 and a negative 3. How about that? 4x times x is 4x squared. And now look at this. I have positive 8x, negative 3x. That gives me my 5x. And negative 3 and positive 2 gives me the negative 6. Isn't that great? Now I'm going to make use of the zero product property again. So 4x minus 3 equals 0, or x plus 2 equals 0. One of these two must be 0, because I have, if I plug in a value for x, this is going to be a single number. If I plug in a value for x, this is going to be a single number. So that would be like p times q. One of the two of them has got to be 0. If I multiply anything by 0, I get 0. Both of them can be 0. That's fine as well. So let's do the following. I've got 4x, negative 3. I'm going to add 3 to both sides. 0 plus 3. Negative 3 plus positive 3, that's the 0, so I'm left with 4x on this side. On this side, I am left with 3. Now what do I do? Well, I can multiply both sides by a quarter. 1 over 4 multiplied 1 over 4. Remember, that's over 1, that's over 1. And now I have 1 times 4 and 4 times 1. That's just 4 over 4, which is just 1. Or otherwise, we say we cancel these two 4s. 1 4 in the numerator, 1 denominator, and I'm just left with x. And on this side, I'm left with 3 over 4. What about this side? Well, I've got x plus 2. Let's subtract 2 from both sides. There's my negative 2, my negative 2. I have not changed anything. That just gives me 0. So I have x on the left-hand side equals negative 2. So I've got these two solutions. Let's verify. You can always get 100% for these kind of problems in an exam, because you can verify your solution. Let's start with x equals 3 over 4, 3 quarters. Let's do that. There's a 4. I'm going to put it over 1 and then multiply by, instead of x, I'm putting 3 over 4 squared plus, let's put 5 over 1. And instead of x, I'm putting 3 over 4 minus, let's put 6 over 1 equals 0. Now let's rewrite this one. This is going to be 4 times 3 in the numerator. Let's get the trusty NVIDIA ruler. And in the denominator, I've got 4 times 4. 4 times 4, 16. I could have done it on its own. Now remember, there's another 3 there. See how easy it is to forget things? There's my 4 over 1, and then 2 3s, and then 2 4s. So I could also put a 1 and a dot, so 1 times 4 times 4. Plus, 5 times 3 is 15 in the numerator, 1 times 4 is 4 in the denominator, minus 6 over 1 equals 0. So now look at this, that 4 and that 4 can cancel each other out because that would just be 4 divided by 4, that's just 1. And I have multiplication here, there's no addition, subtraction, this is one single term, so I can do this cancellation. So 3 times 3 is 9 over 4 plus 15 over 4. Now I can add these two because the denominator is the same, but look at the 6, the denominator is 1, so now I have a problem. But let's do it on the side. I've got negative 6 over 1. How can I get this denominator to be 4? Well, let's just take this and multiply it by 1. Anything multiplied by 1 is just 1. I don't have to worry about doing something to the right-hand side because I haven't changed nothing. I'm just going to rewrite this. Instead of 1, I'm writing this as 4 over 4. That's just still 1. And that is negative 24 over 4. And 24 divided by 4 is indeed 6. So I have changed nothing. So minus 24 over 4, that's great, equals 0. And now I've got 4 in the denominator. I can just have a common denominator now. They're all the same, meaning I can do this. 9 plus 15 is 24, minus 24, well, that's the 0. 0 over 4 is 0. 0 divided by 4 is 0. 0 equals 0. I have verified that this solution is indeed correct. Now let's check on the other one. Let's check on the other root. So these two solutions, remember, another word for them are the roots of this equation. So let's check x equals negative 2. Let's do that substitution. So I've got 4 times negative 2 squared plus 5 times negative 2 minus 6 equals 0. Negative 2 times negative 2 is 4, 4 times 4 is 16, 5 times negative 2 is negative 10, and another negative 6 equals 0. Negative 6, negative 10, negative 6 is negative 16, plus 16, well, that's the 0, equals 0, and indeed the solution is correct as well. Now, wasn't that just a little bit of fun? Now, I really want you to do as many of those as is possible. But we don't have time to do thousands of them in a lecture like this. So the next thing I want to talk to you about is completing the square. And I'm going to put a little arrow there. So that's going to be a definition for us, completing the square. So now we're going to get to more complicated quadratics that are not so easy to solve that we can have our two factors in something very simple such as this. What about if it's more complicated than that? Now I want you to think of the following situation. What if we have x squared plus bx? Now we're going to do a little bit of drawing, and this is quite a bit of fun. How do I talk about x squared and bx? Now let's add these two things together, and we're going to use a little drawing. So there we go. Imagine I have this square and the side. So you've got to imagine that's a square, that I have the sides x and x. So that would be x squared. Don't you think the area of that would be x squared? And let's have another little shape there. So that is also x, but let's make this b. So surely that should be bx. So that's x squared for an area, and that's b times x, b times x. So I'm looking at x squared plus bx as two of these little shapes. Now, if I combine these two, that was a square. So please imagine that these sides are all equal length. That's a square. If I add this, it's no longer a square. If I put them together, I no longer have a square. What if I still want a square though? What would I do? Now look at this, just follow along. So imagine here, I still have my x squared. So I still have that this is x and this is x. But let's do the following. Let's chop this into a half. If I chop that into a half, let's have them here. I'm trying my best to draw here. Now it's in half. And what if I lay another half out here? So now I've split that into two and I've laid them down here. Now this side and that side, those are both b over 2. And this side is b over 2. That side is still x. I've just cut it in half. So if that was b, now this is a half b, and that's a half b. And what is left here? Well, if I want to complete the square, I have to add another little square there. And look at this square. That's b over 2 for this side and b over 2 for this side. And now, look at this. If I combine those four together, I have completed the square. Now I have a proper square again. Because this side, there's an x and a b over 2. So that would be that length. And here we have an x and a b over 2. So the both sides would be equal and I have completed the square. But let's think about what we have here. We have an x squared. Definitely we have an x squared. Now we still have a bx because there is the half of that bx. There's the other half of that bx. I combine them. I still have my bx. And what do I have here? I have b over 2 squared. There's the two sides, b over 2 squared. And now if I add all of them, I have a new square. And that's what we call completing the square. Now, hopefully you followed along with my little attempt at a drawing. So let's do an example where this becomes absolutely necessary for us to solve this quadratic. I've got x squared plus bx plus c is equal to 0. So in our example, I'm going to have for this, I'm going to have x squared plus, let's make it 6x plus 7. Now you're going to struggle if you want to find integer values with a 7 and a 6. Such that with a 1 and a 7, such that you get 6. That's going to be very difficult. So let's complete the square. So I'm going to have x squared plus 6x. Now look at this. There's my b. So b is 6 in this instance. It's 6. And what do I want for completing the square? Well, I want to take b, which is 6, and I want to divide it by 2, and I want to square that. So there's my b divided by 2, and I want to square that. But because I've added it, I've also got to subtract it. Or, at the very least, let's add it to the other side. So that was my original problem. I've got to have my plus 7 there. So let's just do everything in one step. Let's bring that 7 over to the side. So I'm subtracting 7 from both sides. I'm going to have a negative 7 on this side. But I've added this to the left-hand side, so I better add that to the right-hand side as well. Hopefully you followed along. I've just skipped a step. And I don't like doing that, so let's do that right here. I've got x squared plus 6x plus 7. I'm subtracting 7 from this side, and I'm subtracting 7 from this side. That's how I got the negative 7 on this side, and the 7 has disappeared from this side. But because I've completed the square on this side, I have to add that to that side as well. Plus 6 over 2 squared plus 6 over 2 squared. I still have my equation. I haven't changed anything. But now we have something very special. Look at this, x squared plus 6x plus 6 over 2, which is just 3 squared. Now, isn't that something special? Let's just rewrite it just to make it clear. X squared plus 6x, 6 divided by 2 is 3, so I've got plus 3 squared equals, and here I've got negative 7 plus 6 times 2 is 36 divided by 4. Now we can simplify that a little bit. We'll do that shortly. But what I want to do is concentrate on this left-hand side. This is now what we call a perfect square. Look at this. X plus 3, x plus 3. Look at that. X times x is x squared. 3 times 3 is 9, there's 9, 3x plus 3x, 6x. So what I have here is x plus 3 squared on the left-hand side, and that is why we want to complete the square, so that we can get to this step. Having x plus something squared, so instead of being able not to work with that, I'm only going to work with this section here. Let's do that, that section there. I'm completing the square such that I can get to this step. That's a very good step to get. Let's do the right-hand side. I want to take the negative 7 over 1, and I want 4 in the denominator, so I'm just going to multiply it by 1, so I'm not changing anything there, plus 36 over 4. So here we're going to have, on this side, we have 4 in our denominator, and in the numerator, we're going to have negative 28 plus 36. Negative 28 plus 36. On this side, I still have x plus 3 squared, and on the right-hand side, let's just add that here, negative 28 plus 36 is 8 over 4, and 8 over 4 is just 2. Now look at this equation versus the problem that we started with. It's much simpler. Why is it simpler? Because what I can now do is take the square root of both sides. I'm going to take the square root of both sides. Now remember, if I have x plus 3, and I square that, what I'm doing with the square root is I'm doing this to the power a half, and 2 times a half is 1. So on this side, I just have left x plus 3, and on this side, I must remember that it must be positive or negative square root of 2. Because if this was a negative out front, if I square that, I would get the positive side of that. So I've got to have x plus 3, and on this side, I've got to have the positive negative 2. I'm taking the square root, so I must get positive negative. Now I'm just going to subtract 3 from both sides, and so I've got negative 3 plus or minus square root of 2. Now, I've just done the negative 3 on this side, negative 3 on this side, positive 3, negative 3 is 0, so it's just the x on this side. And here I've got negative 3 plus or minus square root of 2, so I've got two solutions, x equals negative 3 plus square root of 2, or x equals negative 3 minus the square root of 2. And isn't that an absolute thing of beauty? That is absolutely beautiful. And there is no way that you would have been able to find these values, to plug them in there, to get a solution straight from there. Completing the square would be your only solution. And what I want to leave for you as a task is to plug this value into x, plug this value into x, and you'll see you get 0 on the left-hand side, 0 on the right-hand side, and both of these solutions are absolutely correct. Do that for me as an exercise. And so now that we've seen completing the square, and I want you to do more of those examples, we're going to do the quadratic formula. And this really is a thing of beauty. We're going to make use of the We're going to make use of the completing the square, and that's going to help us deliver or create a formula, derive a formula that will help us solve all quadratic equations. Every quadratic equation, doesn't matter how difficult it gets. So let's do that derivation. I'm going to start with ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0. Now, you can follow along with this, but you certainly don't need to know this derivation for you in order just to use the final solution in your solving of your quadratic equations. But go with me on this one. It's quite a bit of fun. So I'm going to have ax squared plus bx. Now, I've got positive c here. I'm just going to have negative c on this side, negative c on this side, which means I'm just going to skip a step. By now, I'm sure you'll allow me to skip these steps. I'm just taking the c, bringing it over to the other side, which means I've got to have a negative. And y, well, forgive me, let's do this. Positive c, I'm going to subtract c from this side, and I'm going to subtract c from this side. So on this side, all my c's disappear, and on the right-hand side, I now have a c. So I think you can see that. Now, what I need to do is to get rid of this coefficient, because what if it's not 1? What if it's 2 or 3? And so how can I get rid of this? Well, I can multiply both sides by 1 over a. So I'm going to multiply this side by 1 over a, and I'm going to multiply that side by 1 over a. I've changed nothing. And so if I multiply, I have got to do distribution. So 1 over a times ax squared over 1, plus I've got 1 over a, and I've got bx over 1. And on the left-hand side, I'm going to have negative c over a. Great. So these two a's can cancel, so I'm left with x squared on its own. Now it has a coefficient of 1, and that's great. That's what I need for completing the square. On this side, I'm going to have b divided by a x. So there's bx, bx divided by a. I'm just writing it in a different way. And on this side, I'm going to have negative c over a. So can I now complete the square? Yes, because look at this. This is just what we had before, x squared plus bx. Now it's a bit more complicated. I have x squared over ba. That is still, in essence, my b. So I have this. And what I want to do is to divide it by 2 and then to square it. That is how we complete the square. We take whatever value is the coefficient of this x to the power 1, this thing, and we divide it by 2. And another way to write this would be b over 2a squared. So make sure you can see why I'm writing it like this. B over a divided by 2 is b over 2a. Those two things are exactly the same. So let's complete the square. I've got x squared plus b over a x. Now I'm going to complete the square by adding b over 2a squared, and that equals negative c over a, and I'm adding it to the side as well, b over 2a squared. Great stuff. What do I have? I have a b over a, b over 2a. This is a absolutely beautiful complete square, so I can write x plus b over 2a squared. If you write this term twice and you do your distribution, you're going to end up right there. And that's exactly what we want. Now on this side, we've got to do a bit of work. So I've got a negative c over a plus, let's do this, it's b squared over 2a squared is 4a squared. So I can't do this addition because I've got an a in the denominator and a 4a squared on that side. So let's do a little bit of work on the side. And this is something you really have to get used to in algebra, doing work on the side. So I've got a 4a squared here, b squared over 4a squared, plus how do I change this into a 4a squared? Well, I can take this negative c over a, and I can multiply it by 4a over 4a. So this is just 1, so I'm taking this in the value and I'm multiplying it by 1, so nothing changes. And now look at this. I'm going to have negative 4ac in the numerator, negative 4ac over a times 4 times a is 4a squared plus b squared over 4a squared. Now I've got 4a squared. Look at that as a common denominator. On this side, I still have x plus b over 2a squared. And that's just such a lovely way to go from there by completing the square such that I can write it like this. Isn't that beautiful? So let's have x plus b over 2a, and I've got that squared equals, let's just rewrite this with a common denominator. Come here, you trusty NVIDIA ruler. There we go. I've got 4a squared as my common denominator. So I'm just going to rewrite this in a different order. Let's have b squared minus 4ac. Now what can we do? Well, we can get rid of the square by taking the square root of this side. And I've also got to take the square root of this side. I just have to remember that on one of the sides, it's plus or minus. And so I've gotten rid of the square root. This side would just be x plus b over 2a. And on the right-hand side, I can do the following. Look at this. I can rewrite this as b squared minus 4ac. Now you've got to think back at these rules that we discussed many lectures ago, divided by the square root of 4a squared. I am allowed to rewrite this as 2 square roots. And what happens here? Look at this denominator. Let's do some side work here. It's 2 times 2 times a times a. And so what do we have here? Well, we have 2 squared to the power a half times a squared to the power a half. And what is this left here? 2 times a half, 2 times a half, that's 1, 1. I'm left with 2a. So here we are left with the square root of b squared minus 4ac divide by, and you can just see it from there. 4a squared, the square root of all of that has got to be 2a. So I'm going to have a 2a there. I just have to remember that I still have to have my plus minus somewhere, just to remember that I am taking the square root, so I have to somewhere have this plus or minus. Because remember, if we take the square root of 9, that is going to equal positive or negative 3. Great. And now all I want to do is isolate x on this side, so I'm going to subtract b over 2a from both sides. I'm going to do that in one step. So I get rid of the b over 2a on this side. Now I have a negative b over 2a on this side, plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, all divided here over 2a. And look at this. I've got the same denominator, so I can rewrite this as the following. X equals minus b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac. Let's close our square root there. All over 2a. And look at what we have. Look at what we have. I'm definitely going to put a green marker there because this is so beautiful. And I want you to remember this. This is the quadratic formula. If I give you any problem, ax squared plus bx plus c, a will be a specific value, b will be a specific value, c will be a specific value. You plug them in. There's b, there's a, there's c, there's a. You plug them in. There's a positive and a negative. So let's be clear about this. We're going to have x equals minus b plus the square root of b squared minus 4ac over 2a. Let's just put our lines in. Or we're going to have x equals minus b minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac divided by 2a. So I'm going to get two solutions for x. Now, with this quadratic formula, I can solve any example problem that you give me. Isn't this a thing of beauty? As I say, you can enjoy this, see if you can do it on your own, but this is where you need to get. I can now solve for any quadratic formula. So let's do an example using that quadratic formula. Let's do 2x squared. Let's do 2x squared plus 8x plus 7 equals 0. Let's do that. It's going to be very difficult for you to write this out as some factors of x, and you have a leading coefficient there, so that's going to be a problem. But look at this. A equals 2, b equals 8, and c equals 7. So let's use that quadratic formula, and I'm going to write it out here. Let's do two separate ones. We're going to have x equals minus b plus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, where's my ruler, there we go, over 2a, and we're going to have, or x equals minus b minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac divided by 2a. And so let's just plug in, let's just substitute negative b, so that'd be negative 8, plus the square root of b squared, that'll be 8 squared, minus 4, times a is 2, times c is 7. So there we go. Divided by 2 times a is 2 times 2. Or on this side, we're going to have x equals negative b, that's still negative 8, minus the square root of 8 squared, minus 4, times 2, times 7. And that is all going to be over 2 times 2, 2 times 2. Isn't that beautiful? X equals negative 8 plus the square root of 8 times 8 is 64. And now 4 times 2 is 8, 8 times 7 is 56, so minus 56. Divided by, we have 2 times 2 is 4. And on this side we have all x equals negative 8 minus the square root. Now we can do this. This is exact same as that. So 64, we've taken 64 minus 56, well, that's just 8. And we're going to divide that by 4. Now we just have to simplify a couple of things. Let's think about what happens to the square root of 8. The square root of 8 is 2 times 2 times 2. So there's 2 of those. So that'll be just 2. I can bring 2 out. Square root of 2. Why? Because I've got 2 squared there, and I'm doing that to the half. There is another 2 there to the half. And that cancels out, so I'm just left with a 2. So I can bring one of those 2s out as a single value. And the square root of 8 equals 2 square root of 2. So x equals negative 8 plus square root of 2. So let's put the other 2 in there. Over 4. Or x equals negative 8 minus 2 square root of 2 divided by 4. And you can leave it there, but we can simplify just a little bit. And so let's do this. X equals, now you can do this all in one step, and I really want you to understand that you can do this in one step. I've got something plus something divided by 4, and I've got this common denominator. So on this one, let's just do this step by step. This will be the same as negative 8 over 4 plus 2 square root of 2 over 4. Remember, that's the same denominator. I can rewrite it in this sense. So I'm just breaking that apart. And so here I'm going to have negative 2, 8 divided by 4, that's negative 2, and 2 divided by 4, that's a half, plus 1 half square root of 2.